Say, Father, thank you for your word. I hear it. I believe it. I receive it. That I may be a doer of it. You increase. I decrease. Father, have your way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Christmas is here. Wow. I was going to minister on Resurrection Sunday. It went so fast. Hallelujah. And I don't know about you, but in this season, the most important thing for us to do is to keep our focus on the reason for the season. I mean, really, we're celebrating his birthday, and it's pretty sad when we celebrate someone's birthday and we forget the one we're celebrating the birthday of. I mean, this is a season that people make a Christmas list. Everything they want. Hallelujah. Okay, then. It's got to be a season that today we need to be reminded before the season starts full swing, how to handle the pressure of this season, the pressure that it's always so commercial. It's always about, you know, what you're going to get me, what I'm going to get you. Well, already, did I get you that last year? Well, I don't remember because I didn't write it down. Well, do they really need that? Well, they got me something last year, so should I get them something this year? But I'm broke. I don't have the money, so what am I going to do? And I don't know where I'm going to get. And, well, maybe I just get everybody a $5 whatever, and maybe I just wait and get nobody. No, I won't do anything. Well, whatever it is that we go through this year and every year, for me the most exciting things is that it's a season to, even apart from giving, it's a season of receiving. Yeah. And it's a season of receiving the only gift that matters the most. And to receive that gift in another measure, if you already have received the gift that Jesus sees, because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe on him will not perish but have everlasting life. Actually, he gave himself. Not only it's the greatest gift, but he gave himself. And it means so much to us. And I believe that if we can just take the time in this season, like in no other season, to receive the gift to another level, to meditate on what does that mean. Because sometimes we have the tendency to think we know. And if we think we know, we don't take time to know. And what we knew, since we knew it, we don't think of knowing it again. But there's so much life that helps us in every situation when we receive the gift, when we partake of everything that Jesus sees in our life, our Savior, our Healer, our Deliverer, the one that didn't just do what he did for us one day to have eternal life, even though that's the greatest gift in itself, and we could shout hallelujah and receive eternal life. Amen. But he gave us his very life, that when we receive the gift and we believe it in our heart, then we become born again, and we carry the greatest gift everywhere we go, and we never cease to unwrap it and discover what it means. And to me, when I think of receiving, the Bible says in Matthew 10, I think verse 9, it says, freely you have received, freely you give. There's something about receiving before you can have a giving heart. Amen. And this season, I encourage you to make your gifts personal. Because when we receive his gift, what I love about the Lord is that it's a personal relationship. We all receive that gift for ourselves, and in different ways, and in different measure based on what we're going through. To me, that was the hardest thing to receive, because the Bible in Ephesians chapter 2 says that you are saved by grace through faith. It's not because of your good works. It's not because suddenly you're all this and all that. But it is the gift. It is the gift of God. A gift is a gift. A gift is a gift. When I think of people giving things to one another, the greatest things that you can give to someone is to let them know about Jesus. For you, for all of us, sorry, I need some water. Oh, let's go to John 4. I got thirsty and I thought of the water in John 4. That was so funny. Holy Spirit is so funny. Isn't he wonderful? Because the world around us will make us feel so hindered when you cannot give something material. But if you know the Lord and you have received the greatest gift, you actually have the most precious gift to share, to give with somebody else. The most precious. There is nothing more valuable than you can give to someone that you, to give them a word by giving them what the word of God says. There is nothing more precious than you can do to anyone in your life, your family, your friends. Even if all you have is a card that you get at the Dollar Tree and you look for a scripture and you put a scripture on it, never let the enemy tell you, well, I don't have nothing to give. You have the most valuable thing to give. There is nothing more precious than to give of him, of his life, to share with someone, to take the time to ask the Lord the scripture that he has for someone. I love when people give me little notes and there's a scripture on it. It's more precious to me because they took the time to ask the Lord. What word do you have for them? What scripture? It's never about the amount of money you spend. I don't know when the world started doing that. I don't know when it started. But there's so much pressure everywhere that you turn to, and it becomes this commercial thing that even children who are young children, they make their list and they ask for things that are like, whoo! You know, they used to ask for a little truck. Now if they're 16, they'll ask for a real one. They used to ask like for a play phone, you know, those yellow phone with the thing and the cord that gets tangled. Now they want a real phone. And they don't just want a real phone. They want like a smart one. Well, how smart is that? They want all these things. And believe me, there's nothing about blessing your children with whatever the Lord lead you to bless. But we cannot bless others without first sharing with them the reason for this season. And we need to teach them on our list, not just to what people want, but they should make a list of really what they can give. And what can we give to the Lord this season? How many times it's his birthday and nobody think of him? If it was me and it was my birthday, I would be so bummed. Right? It's a good thing he's not in the flesh. All right. But look at this story in John 4. And let's start at verse 7. It says, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. And Jesus said to her, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria, she said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Oh Lord, that we may know the gift. Oh Lord, that all of us will know you to another place, that we will never thirst for the wrong thing again. Or that we would be so filled and so content and so satisfied because we know you, that we will never thirst again. That we will never even think of even things that we want, because we have all that we need, because we need you. I love that passage, because the woman, she is approached by someone who usually doesn't talk to her. Because Jesus, because he came and now he's thirsty, he has a human need, and he goes to someone and says, "Hey, give me to drink." How many people around us do we ever meet who come to us and they have a need? And Jesus, he, instead of her, you know, giving him something to drink, she's shocked. "Why are you talking to me? Why are you approaching me? Usually nobody talks to me. I'm just a Samaritan." And Jesus, he says, in another way, he says, "If you would know who I am, if you would know who I am, you wouldn't be concerned about who you are anymore. If you just knew who I am, you would know that I come with everything that you need. I'm just asking you for a little bit in return. I just need a drink." Hallelujah. But if you can just know the gift, then you would have in your belly a well that will never run out, and you will be satisfied in all things. Oh, I know around Christmas, many people think they know Jesus in their head. But there's something that happens when you receive him in your heart. There's something that changes, that what you were going after before, no longer you thirst for. There's something that happens once you receive Jesus. My greatest prayer is that if anyone in here today doesn't know him like that, I pray today the Holy Spirit open up the veil and that you receive the greatest gift in your heart, even though it's December 4th and not December 25th, that you will receive the greatest gift. Gift of all, that the world around you, you won't have to care how much money you have and what you don't have and what you should go after and what other people are doing, but you would find joy and love and peace, and you would find a place in your heart that suddenly, even if in the natural you don't have anything, you will still feel with joy because you have the giver of life, the giver of joy. Joy, the giver of love, the greatest giver of everything that you need. The giver that once you believe in him, you be reconciled to your heavenly Father. And now you're a child of God. And then the Bible tells us in Romans, and then you are heir and co-heir. Joint heir with Christ. Woo! My God! I used to work for attorneys that were estate planning attorneys. They would do wills and estates. So I would deal a lot with heirs. Yeah. Oh, since we're drinking water. And the thing that blessed me the most is that an heir, when a will is drawn up, if you have children, you decide, okay, all my children, we're going to divide the estate or what we have equally. Or you write a will and you say, my auntie can have the dishes and my cousin can have my screwdriver. you decide what you're going to do. But if you have an estate and if you're an heir, then it's divided by everyone who is here. But a joint heir. If I'm a joint heir with you, and I have the estate, this house, this church, for example, and I say we are joint heir, then you're not going to get a piece and me another piece. It's not going to be separate. It's not going to be you're going to have 25%, 25%, 25%, 25% divided in four. If I am a joint heir with you, then it is our house. It is ours. What you have, I have. You don't have a percentage and me another. I am heir and I am joint heir with Christ. Oh my God. Oh my God. And everything that he has, I have. Whew. All right then. I'm glad you're happy about that. If we learn to receive the gift, then we also learn to receive our inheritance, everything that we have that he has made possible. And because he's the first fruit, because he's the first creature, because he's the one who came to give his life so that we could have life, then everything that he did in such a way that you can be sure of your inheritance. It's sad when I see people, when someone goes home to be with the Lord, fight over a spoon. Fight over who's going to get the china. No, Mama said I could have it. No, she told me I was having it. And mind you, if they're born again, they can hear that old conversation. They can hear people fighting over things that don't matter. And Jesus, he wants us in this season to receive what he has done and what he's giving us in another measure. And the things that's not material. It's not material. And I know not everybody will understand how happy you are and you don't have a diamond ring. Somebody one day said, oh, you don't have any diamond rings. I said, no. But I am a diamond. No? I don't have a diamond ring, but the glory of the Lord, I pray, shines from glory to glory. Hallelujah! Because there's some things that we need to be free from, the materialistic spirit that hinders us from even enjoying one another's company and just loving one another. If I give you love, if I pray for you, to me that's the gift. If you pray for me, I receive the gift. I'm not never thinking all they did was pray for me. I can't even believe they didn't even get me a gift. Never it would even come to me. So no brownie point. Amen. I appreciate the gifts, but I give God credit and praise and honor for the gifts. So this young woman, if I continue the story, the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Like, what do you mean you have living water? What are you talking about? Because she's seeing things in the natural. And you're greater than your father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself as well as his sons and his livestock. And Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. And then the woman, she said, "Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst." But then she says this passage that's so powerful. She says, no, come here to draw. In other words, give me what you're talking about, because I'm tired of coming every day to draw water. Don't give me something temporary. Don't give me something that's going to make me happy on a Sunday and I have to wait for the following Sunday. Don't give me something that's temporary. Give me of that water and then make sure that I never have to come here to draw again. Sometimes we get tired of the day by day going to work, coming back home, day by day, Christmas after Christmas, going through the same thing. And the Lord is taking us to a point this season that there would be like an awakening in the people of God, that the people of God will know, wait a minute, I have the greatest gift to give. Wait a minute, I'm going to look for thirsty people and I'm going to share the life of the Lord. Hallelujah. But how can we give if we don't first receive? And we have to receive it, but sometimes we receive it and we have the temptation to go back to draw the same waters again and again. And we have to go again and again. Why? Because they don't satisfy you. If you drink cognac, you'll be thirsty again. If you drink coffee, you'll have a caffeine boost, but then you'll need another one. Whatever it is that's quenching our thirst, and whatever it is that people can buy us or give us in the natural, can never satisfy us. Never satisfy us. Jesus, he starts reading her life and tell her, "No, I know, you know, you don't have a husband, and you know the story." And then she's so excited that she's so changed that she leaves a water pot. That means she believes what she received to the point that she leaves what she used to carry, because now Jesus carries her. There's something about receiving his word to another level, to receiving words in a way that we can share it with others to bring life. You are distributors of God's glory. Wow. You, not me, you. Me too. But I'm saying not me, the pastor, and not you. But we together are distributors of God's glory. Today, there's many people here that needs more of him. I need more. Who needs more of him? Who needs to receive more of him? We all need more of him. The Lord, we're about to celebrate his birthday and get busy with this and that. And he's like, "Don't forget me." And even before you start this season of celebration, receive me in another measure. And every day of your life, receive me more and more. And I will be the gift that never stops giving. I will be the gift that you will start unwrapping and discovering things that you didn't even know you had. How do we do that when we're so busy? We do it by faith. In our heart, by as often as you can, be aware of him. Put your mind upon him. Exercise your mind. Keep your thoughts. Lift him up. Think of him. Think of him. Think of him. Make your gift to others personal. Don't get people something that you want. That's what I love about the Lord. Have you ever had a gift that you were like, It would be like somebody buying me a screwdriver. Because not only a gift is to be personal, but it's got to be practical. It's got to be personal for what would be for me, but it's got to be permanent. So as we take the time to receive from him personally, try to take the time when you give a gift or when you pray about a gift. What's personal for them? What do they need? Don't get a Keurig coffee machine to somebody who doesn't drink coffee. You see? If you want one, okay. But don't give to others. Don't give to others the gift that you got last year for someone. That you put in the in the Christmas closet and you repackage for somebody else. Because you know what could happen is you could give it to the person who gave it to you. And you forgot they gave it to you the year before, and that wouldn't be really nice. Amen? Give something personal. Think about that person. And if you what you have is a word, it's the most important thing for you to give. Unconditional love is the greatest gift anyone can give. A meal with someone who is alone during the holidays. A hug and a prayer to someone who is spending the first Christmas alone. Because last year, maybe their mama went home or their daddy. Someone who doesn't have any family, no mate, and they're alone. Look among one another, not just in church, but in your life. I remember one year, years ago, I would put those little $1 Bible, and I would look for doors because I used to live in an apartment, and I would leave little things at the doorstep. Or I would leave a track, or I would leave, you know, a little thing about the church to invite people to the church. I was finding ways to share Jesus, but I was too shy to go to somebody I don't know and say, hey, you know Jesus? I didn't know how to do that. But I thought, I can do that, but I can share the word, and I'll do it without them knowing I even did it. So I would just hurry up and leave. Amen. And I would do it at the restaurant where I used to work. And I would put it in people's, you know, things. And I would just do it like that because this way I would share. But the greatest thing that I've learned is when I would pray. I would pray, Father, let this season and every season, let this be the day. Let this be the season that people who need to know you won't celebrate it not knowing you. Let it be the season that they would receive the greatest gift of all. Let not this be a season that I would talk to anybody and not at least share with them what you mean to me. Maybe I can't tell them about you like a preacher can't, I used to think. But I can tell them what you did in my life. How you have quenched my thirst. How you have changed me. And how you want to do that to everybody. Because according to you, you desire by your life to get us to be all joint heirs. Hallelujah. So today my question to you is this, as we all want more, can we, by faith, the Lord is here. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And he's right here today. Today. I know sometimes we think, well, I'll do it tomorrow or next Christmas. But today I want to do something different. Before those who already know him who want more come up for prayer, I want to call those who will say that the Holy Spirit is ministering to them right now. And that you just feel his presence and he's calling you and he's touching you and he's grabbing you and everyone around you disappear right now. And all you see is just Jesus. You don't know what it means. You don't know what that means. You don't know what you have to do, not do. And the Lord says all you have to do is believe in your heart and accept this gift from my unconditional love. The Lord says, all I'm asking you is to believe. And if it's you and you say, I believe, today I'm going to ask you to come first that I can pray for you. So close your eyes. The Bible says that if we believe, we ask him to come into our heart. The Bible says that whosoever thirst, the Lord says, if you thirst, if you believe, come unto me. If you are here today and you don't even understand my weird accent, you don't even know, have a clue what I'm talking about, but the Holy Spirit is nudging you to receive him, then all of us together lift up your hands and say, Lord, we believe that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe on him will not perish, but have everlasting life. I believe, I repent, I turn around, I leave my water pot. Fill me, I receive you into my heart. More, Lord, more, Lord. I am born again. I will never thirst again. I receive the greatest gift. Jesus. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.